anything we choose to be born, or we fit it to the times we're born into. We begin with equality. That's the origin, isn't it? That's justice.
See, we've shown that a people can endure awful sacrifice and yet cohere.
Blessed Jose Maria taught that for the great majority of Christians, all of us are called to perfection, priests, sisters, and the rest of us, ordinary Wananchi, so to speak, in church. Then what are the ordinary Wananchi supposed to do to, in fact, attain the perfection to which all the children of God are called? And he says that, in fact, your ordinary work and the things that you do in your ordinary life, the ordinary duties of whichever, myself as a mother, as a doctor, as an administrator, are the substance of the thing that we are supposed to use to achieve this perfection to which we are all called. And he made it very simple, which is perhaps what is so attractive about Oludhe, in that nothing changes, but everything changes. Because you since this is what you do to attain this perfection, you have to do it with perfection. Try very hard that the work that you do has a certain standard of professional perfection or human perfection. It's good to look at, it's understandable, it reaches people, and whatever it is that you are called to do, you try to do with this kind of excellence. Yes, I talk a lot to my children. Just sit around talking. This is very powerful because my parents talked a lot to us. I had parents who were very available. It's one thing that I regret that I'm not more available as a parent. But I had parents who talked to us constantly and all the time. So I try to talk to my children a lot. Just ordinary things, either we are funny, they love stories. My youngest is constantly asking for stories. My younger son is also a very funny person. I mean, he sees life from an extraordinary angle completely. And so it's very interesting dealing with them person to person. And for me, the work has helped me to see my children in an entirely different light. They are not just people who I happen to have given birth to. I hope to raise them to be more or less good citizens and will pass on. They are eternal souls created in the image of God that have been entrusted to me by the mercy of God for a very short period of time. And I tell you, that period of time is going faster than I like to think. The hospice is an institution that is dedicated to caring for children who are HIV/AIDS. That is terminal care, basically. These children have to be children who have absolutely no one to take care of them, or whose parent or available relative is too sick to take care of them, which is the tragedy of this disease. So a very high percentage of the children are orphaned. And the ones who are not orphaned have parents who are at the brink of death and cannot provide care. Because of the fears that are associated with the disease, many of our children have been rejected outright by their close relatives. I was called to the hospice by the then medical coordinator for the Archdiocese of Nairobi, who knew of my work and the fact that I was a pediatrician. And that I like children, basically. I just like children. And she told me, Margaret, will you come with me? I want to show you something. She was very cagey. I think she thought I would probably run for it if I knew what it is that she was going to show me. And we went to the place, and at that time, things were a bit chaotic. And it was a revelation. I couldn't walk away. This hospice at this time is run by the Kotolengo community. And when I saw it, I decided that there was no way I could handle that situation. So I ran for a very good friend with whom we had fought many battles in Cairo and Beijing and such places, and asked to come and assist me with the work. Her name is Lucy Dam. Put order into the place so that we could attend. At that time, it was considered normal, for example, for a child to die of anemia or fever or whatever. If you have AIDS, you're dying anyway. What's the difference if you die today or tomorrow? We have worked, and things have changed. We have children who, at first, we thought that they would live up to the age of 5, but now we have 13-year-olds, and we have to face issues of young adolescents, in fact. I love the children because I think they have taught me more than what I have been able to give them, which is a very limited amount of medical knowledge. You can treat some of their infections, relieve some of their pain, not all of it. These children are frequently very ill. Recently we had a rather terrible epidemic within an epidemic, so half the children were in some sort of agony, muscular pain all the time that didn't seem to respond to anything, including prophetic. I have yet to find out exactly what virus was going around. But the children are in love with life, and to see them fight so much to retain hold of life, to enjoy their life every day, for me was a revelation. Because I thought that people would be sad around here, after all we are dying. But some die. And I have had to make peace with the fact that I'm giving care to children who will eventually not live. Some small percentage, about 30% of the lot, are lucky enough to recover. 20 to 30%, it depends on the year and the ages that we admit, and go and are adopted in normal homes. But the rest are stuck with us for life, whatever their life is. And so I'm in constant contact with death, with people who are dying, and it has changed my life in some very profound ways. And again, this is I think something that being in Opus Dei has helped me deal with more effectively, because since each person is even a little child who is not even 0 days old, because some are brought in prematurely born, has got the dignity of a child of God. And it's a chance to give love and affection as well as medical care to somebody usually who cannot say thank you because they are already carrying a big cross. And for me, really, it's made me appreciate more deeply. Touching death has made me be able to touch life and know its beauty. And so I have also learned, like a child, to live day by day and to enjoy and take out of every day everything that it has to offer, and to do in that particular day everything that I can do in it. It's something that you can only learn from children, in the sense that children don't have a yesterday. They have no memory of things that are gone. They don't have a future. Therefore, they do not procrastinate their joys and their happiness. they are sick and dying, yet they put such effort into their schoolwork, because we have school-going children, and our children do extremely well in school, I'm proud to say. And when I look at that, I say, each day is a gem, it's something that will not come again. Therefore, I have to live it like there is no yesterday, which I cannot change, and there is no tomorrow, which may not find me here. And it's a beautiful place to work. You have to come and see the children.
Oh, don't keep your distance. Have I said too much? There's nothing more I can think of to say to you. But all you have to do is look at me to know that every word is true.
But I'm a person who is very happy. I think each day of my life is an extraordinary gift. For a very long time, now I'm 42, but for a very long time I would be riding in a bus coming into town and looking out and thinking, what a beautiful day in which to be alive. Mm-hmm. And it just gets better. So I am a very happy person. I feel that I'm a very fortunate person also, because the things that God has put in my hands to do are things that are really worthwhile, for which people are grateful, it's a chance to give a service. For me, to serve as we are required to serve as Christians, in fact, comes in a matter of day-to-day work, and for that I'm truly grateful. Yeah. Time, creating time for all the things that I want to do. I want to write some more. I write, put out some books, a novel and an educational book for parents with my husband. And I have contributed here and there to various other publications. I really yearn to write, but I just never seem to have the time. And that is something that I find difficult.
Try to govern a country when you can become a saint.
Was it me? Was it you? Was it all the little things that I didn't do? Trying to move on, but I can't. No, I can't imagine being someone else's man. Girl, I tried and tried a million times to get you off my mind. It's not that easy, no, not that easy. Don't you know how hard it is for me to smile and say goodbye? It's not that easy. No, it's not that easy. It's not over, not for me. You still have so much faith, and I still believe. You're my weakness, you're my strength, and one without the other just don't make no sense. Girl, I tried and tried a million times to get you off my mind. It's not that easy, no, not that easy. Don't you know how hard it is for me to smile and say goodbye? It's not that easy, no, it's not that easy. It's not as easy for me as it is for you. Talk about it. It's not that easy. Listen, what am I meant to do without your love, your love? What am I meant to do without your love? Oh. to smile and say goodbye. It's not that easy, no, it's not that easy.